I hope this screen is visible. As the schedule was mailed message to you all over the WhatsApp, today I'll be dealing with flowchart and algorithms. Others please do not present. So according to the schedule, it was I'm supposed to take or I'll be taking algorithms and flowchart. So before that, let me tell you about a brief about this course, which is problem solving and programming in C, which is in short referred to as PSPC. It basically covers C programming aspects and also how you can solve the problems using the C programming. In fact, the first part, the main focus to be given is on problem solving, and we'll be using C as a programming language to solve the problems. So you might be asking what problems might be there to solve. Of course, you have already studied this course. You might be knowing that all the programs that you are practiced or you will be practicing or you have been given the assignment, all these are the considered as problems, and you are required to solve the problems using the C programming. But before we actually start solving the problems, we need to devise or should have a one design strategy as to how to approach the problem. And this is where the importance of algorithm as well as flowchart comes into picture. Okay, so we use basically algorithm to, it's actually a design process wherein we will understand how that problem is to be solved and devise some steps to solve that problem. Because say for example, suppose I want to add say two numbers. So I'll suppose I if I directly get started with the problem definition, say to add two numbers, right? So for a human mind, it is very easy. Adding two numbers is easy because we know how to do it. But for a computer, it doesn't understand, because it's a, even though it is a fast, it is very fast compared to humans, but it is very dumb. Means it cannot have a logical thinking. So we need to feed everything to the computer. Hence, we require algorithm which specifies the steps that the computer should follow or the machine should follow to successfully solve that problem. This is where the importance of algorithm comes into picture. Okay, so once we understand why we use algorithm, we can easily see why flowchart is used. Okay, so if you have any doubts in between, you can put it in the chat box. I will take up the all the questions at the later stage once I finish with my stuff. Okay, so I hope this is clear. So with that, I'll again continue my discussion. So when we talk about algorithms, basically algorithms are used to as a design process to approach the problem. So given the problem, we should think in terms of how a computer can solve it. So you cannot give all the tasks to the computer at once. You have to follow some steps. So you need to follow the steps one at a time. We call it as a sequenced steps. So if you, I hope this screen is visible. If you see this text, it says that an algorithm is a set of rules that precisely define a sequence of operations. This sentence has a lot of meaning. So let me just spend some time in explaining what this means. So what is it? It just says it's basically a definition of an algorithm. So what is an algorithm? It is a set of rules. Set of rules means depending on the problem definition, we will understand how to solve that problem. So that forms a set of rules that precisely define a sequence of operations. As I said, algorithms have to be solved one at a time, or the sub-steps of the algorithm have to be solved one at a time. Hence, we say that it's a sequence of operations. Like say for example, addition of two numbers. Addition of two numbers cannot be performed without having two numbers, right? So to perform addition, we must have first two numbers. So we need to define that sequence. So first we'll have to define the two numbers, then follow it up with the addition, then you can go ahead with the printing that result. So you cannot interchange these steps. Hence the term sequence plays a very critical role. So if you do not follow the sequence, means if you design your algorithm such that it is out of sequence, then computer will not be able to understand or will not be able to solve it in a correct way. So this is the definition of an algorithm. It says, I'll again repeat, an algorithm is a set of rules that precisely define a sequence of operations. So here we need to remember the term set of rules and a sequence of operations. So if you remember these two points, then designing an algorithm becomes easy. So given the problem definition, we need to define or we need to understand how that problem is to be solved and jot down the sequence of steps to solve that problem. This is an algorithm. This is a definition of algorithm. So you might be asking how the term algorithm came into existence. In fact, the word algorithm, it actually comes from the term called algorithmi. It is the Latin form of a Persian mathematician named Al-Khwarizmi. He's a Persian mathematician who was an astronomer and as well as a geographer. So he invented this term, and the name Al-Khwarizmi got translated in Latin. It became algorithmi, and again it became algorithm in English. So this is the basis for the algorithm. So you might see here, this algorithm is not a new term. In fact, this person was lived between 780 to 850 AD. So it's almost like more than 1500 years old. More than 1000 years old, right? So this term algorithm stems from this person. This is just a historical perspective on how that term algorithm came into existence. Okay. Sorry. Now, algorithms can be expressed in many kinds of notation. We can express an algorithm in a natural language kind like statements, as well as pseudocode, as well as flowcharts. So you can see here, we talk about flowchart as a special case of an algorithm. Even though the flowchart looks totally different from an algorithm, but in fact, it's one way of representing algorithm itself. Okay, so this you need to keep it in mind. There are various ways to express algorithms. One of the ways to express an algorithm as a natural language statement, since we use English for communication, we use English like statements to express an algorithm. You can also express an algorithm in a pseudocode fashion, but to be able to do this, you need to have a knowledge of at least one of the programming language. Without that, you will not understand this pseudocode notation. In today's discussion or in this course, for this course, we'll be using or we'll be using the algorithms or writing the algorithms using natural language like statements. So we'll be using English language to represent algorithms. Of course, if you go to the higher semester or higher level of expressing algorithms, you can easily express algorithms using pseudocode also, which is the actual standard norm for expressing the algorithms. But we'll be using or we'll be sticking on to the expressing algorithms using natural language statements or English like statements. So this is about algorithms. Now, having seen what an algorithm is and what are the various ways to express algorithms, we will first take one simple example of writing an algorithm. So I'll directly start with one algorithm. Say I want to express or I want to write an algorithm, say to add two numbers. Okay, so this example I already gave before. So what steps I need to follow is what I'm going to show here. So my problem definition is, write an algorithm to add two numbers and display the result. Remember, we are writing algorithm. The intention of this algorithm is to make the computer understand the sequence of operations. So you might be asking, adding two numbers is a very trivial task, right? So what is there in to write an algorithm? The reason is, we are writing algorithm to make the computer understand. Computer is of course fast, it doesn't have any brain. So we need to feed each and every step for the computer so that it understands how to do that task. So we are given with the task of adding two numbers, and after adding the numbers, it should display the result. So for doing this, what all things are required? Mathematically speaking, to add two numbers, we require two numbers, real numbers. Say if you want to express this in a mathematical form, so we can write it as say C equal to A plus B, right? So this A, B and C are termed as variables. A, B, C are termed as variables even in mathematics, and plus is referred to as an operation or an operator, addition operator. So mathematically speaking, we write this equation to add two numbers and store it in the result called C. Now we need to display the result also. So display means we are getting connected to the monitor or any output device for a computer, so that added result should be displayed as a output. So this is the problem definition. Let us see how to write an algorithm for it. In fact, there are various ways to write an algorithm using English like statements only. I'll be following one preferred approach. So you can follow the similar approaches, but see to it that the algorithm is logically correct and it abides by this definition. That is, it's a set of rules that precisely define a sequence of operations. So your algorithm should not be ambiguous. Why? Because if it is ambiguous, what happens? The computer will not be able to solve that problem because it tries to follow the steps that you feed into as is. It doesn't think, what happens if I don't follow this step? Means it will not understand the repercussions of feeding an ambiguous operation. So you must define a precise sequence of operations and feed them exact set of rules. So taking a very simple example of adding two numbers and displaying it onto the result, I'm going to demonstrate how to write an algorithm for it. So always when you are writing an algorithm, of course, as I said, even when you are using natural language notation, there are various forms or styles of writing algorithms. All the styles are correct, provided that that algorithm follows this definition, which is set of rules that precisely define a sequence of operations. So I will be showing it in one style. You are free to define your own style, but if you are comfortable with the style that I am showing, you are okay to follow that. So always we need to tell the computer that this is the start of the algorithm and this will be my end of the algorithm. So my first step will be, so I will write it like this. Step number one, some of them directly write like this. So even it is okay, no issues, no harm done for that. But I am following this way. So the first step will be always start. Start means it signifies the computer that it should start executing this algorithm, which solves the problem of adding two numbers and displaying the result on the screen. So after the first step, so remember that always the first step will be start according to this style of writing the algorithm. Others might use different styles. This style I prefer. Next, the second step will be to perform addition of two numbers. We require these two numbers or these two variables. So now I can specify the values of these two variables as say A equal to 10 and B equal to 20. Now when we think of computer, how do I basically interact with the computer? I interact with the computer with the help of an input or output devices. So what are these input output devices? You all know that one example of an input device is your keyboard. Mouse is an input device, right? So joystick, which you use for gaming purposes, is also an input device, right? Monitor is your output device. Even projector forms the output device, right? So computer, if it wants to interact with the user, it does so via an output device. And if human wants to interact with the computer, he does so with the help of an input device. So input and output devices act as an interface between computer and humans, right? So now I want to read or I want to specify the values for A and B. How do I do it? Means I want to input the values of A and B to the computer. So obviously I'll have to key in those values via the keyboard, or if I have a GUI, I can specify the values as a text box or a drop down menus, right? So this I signify by writing an English statement like read A comma B. What is the meaning of read A comma B? It means when the second step will be executed by the algorithm or by the computer, it will read the values of A and B from the user. So if you are aware of C, we use scanf for doing this. So how exactly we do it will be the discussion of tomorrow's session. So this is my second step, wherein I am reading the values of A and B. So after this second step is executed, what I have is user or the human would have entered two numbers, and those two numbers would be stored in A and B. Next, I can go ahead with the calculation, which is my step 3. I can directly write C equal to A plus B. Instead of using equal to sign, I can as well use reverse arrow mark, right? So this is because here I will not demonstrate that, but if you are writing it, you can as well write a reverse arrow mark for this. Instead of using equal to sign, you can use a reverse arrow mark. The reason is because the added result will be stored in C. So if you see the moment of the data, this equal to sign to the LHS is your C, and to the RHS is your A plus B. So if you see the value of A plus B, suppose say A is 10 and B is 20, 30 gets stored in C. So if you see the moment of data, it is from moving from right to left. Hence, we signify this with a reverse arrow mark. This is the forward arrow mark, and the exact mirror image of this is a reverse arrow mark. I'll not attempt to do this here because I'm using Word. It is a bit difficult to specify the reverse arrow mark, but when you are writing it in a paper, you can as well use a reverse arrow mark for this statement. Instead of equal to, you can optionally use a reverse arrow mark. What if I use equal to sign? No harm done, it is still correct. Okay, so this is my third step. Then I have the result of addition of two numbers. Then I will go ahead with displaying the result, which is simply say print C. You can see here print C. The computer will understand that whatever is the value of C has to be displayed as a value. So if A and B are 10 and 20, C will be displayed as 30. So here you can use, as I am following the algorithm which uses English like statement, I have the freedom to choose any of the keywords. Instead of read, I can also say input A and B. Instead of print, I can also say display C. It is left to you. You can also elaborate like this, input the values of A and B. You can also say display the value of C. But you can see here, if I try to elaborate each step, it becomes clumsier and understandability of that algorithm becomes diminished. Hence, we usually do not follow more elaboration of these each steps. We try to specify them with the small English words. Hardly one or two words, keywords should suffice. So instead of saying input the values of A and B, I can either write input or I can write read A and B. So if you want A instead of A comma B, you can as well write A and B, or you can also replace this with the ampersand symbol. Read A and B, C equal to A plus B, display C. So I have done whatever is the problem that is given, and then I should instruct the computer to stop. So this is my fifth step, stop. So if this is my algorithm, you can see here the first step should be always ideally should be start, and the last step should be stop. Now you might be thinking, why is it always required to start and stop? because again you are writing an algorithm keeping in mind the computer or a machine which is actually a dumb, it doesn't have its own brain. So you should tell it to start, and after displaying or after finishing with the task, you must tell it to stop, otherwise it will never stop. So start and stop, even though they look silly or foolish at the beginning, they are must. If you do not write start and stop, then your algorithm is not a sequenced operation and it is not a precisely defined set of rules. So you can see here, with these five steps, the algorithm or the computer will perform the addition of the two numbers and store it in C and display the C onto the screen. So this was my problem definition, to write an algorithm to add two numbers and display the result on the screen. Now you can see here, these steps from 1 to 5, they are sequential. What do you mean by the steps are sequential? Suppose if I interchange these steps, would it still make the algorithm correct? You can just have a thought process on that. What do I mean by that is, suppose I interchange this. Now see what happened. Is the algorithm correct? You can see. I'll start. Suppose see how the visualize how the computer looks at this algorithm. It first starts, then directly it has to perform the addition without knowing the values of A and B. So obviously the computer will do some random or junk operations. It will not question us as to you have not given the values of A and B. So it will assume something and do its own task, right? And then afterwards it asks you to read A and B, then displays the result. So as you can see here, this is not a valid algorithm, because we have not written the algorithm with proper steps. I have swapped the steps, or I have simply made the steps not sequential. So this is an non-sequential algorithm, which is not true according to this definition. So if you remember this definition, you will get the basic idea of how to write an algorithm. So again, I'll repeat, an algorithm is a set of rules which precisely define a sequence of operations. So what makes this algorithm, seemingly correct algorithm, wrong? Because the steps are not sequential. First you need to read, then perform addition, then perform display. I hope this algorithm is clear to you all. So I'll again make this proper. Yeah, now this is a proper algorithm. So I would like to take some questions if you have any at this stage. Yes, anyone having any questions? You can also put it in the chat box. Any questions at this stage? Is the steps to write an algorithm clear? If there are no, yeah? Okay. Right. Fine. So I'll, if there are no questions, I'll go ahead with the next thing. So this is about algorithm. Suppose say, I will take one more example to be more clear about writing an algorithm. Now instead of adding two numbers, suppose say, I want to find, say, the area of a circle. So write an algorithm to find area of a circle and display the result on the screen. So what is the area of a circle? We know that area of the circle, the equation is pi r squared, correct? So pi into r, right? So pi r squared. So you might have guessed, now given this already algorithm for the previous problem definition, you can, if you are clever enough, you can easily make the modification to this algorithm to make it work for area of a circle. So how do I do it? So here you can observe the value of pi is constant. So instead of writing pi here, I can write it as 3.142, and r is the value that we have to read it from the user. So I will say read radius. Here in mathematical notation I am using r as a variable name. Here I am using radius. It is left to me. I have the freedom, or the programmer or the person who is writing the algorithm has the freedom to choose any name that he wants for a variable. So here I am using r, here I am using radius. So once I use radius here in my algorithm, wherever I use that radius, I must always use radius only. I must not use r in my further steps. Now after reading the radius, I can go ahead with the computation of the area. So in fact, optionally I can use one keyword called compute area equal to 3.142. Instead of that multiplication symbol, which is X in the keyboard, I can use one more symbol called star. The reason why I am using star is because this is the operator or symbol that is used in all the programming languages. So I'll now continue. Here instead of pi, I used 3.142, and since I have used radius as a variable, I must also use here as radius. So this is called maintaining the uniformity across all the entire algorithm. Same thing, it is also applicable to the C program when we take up in the tomorrow's session. Okay, so this is my area formula. So I can include one keyword called compute. Even for the addition of two numbers program, I could have used compute here, but that was a default operation, so I did not include. Here I can include that compute area equal to 3.142. Star, it's a symbol which means multiplication. Radius, star radius, because it's pi r square. After that, after computing the area, I can say display area and then stop. So you can see here, with these five steps, by following these steps one at a time, sequentially, one after the other, I will be able to, or computer will be able to perform finding the area of circle in a unambiguous manner. So this is the algorithm to compute the area of circle and display the result on the screen. Most of the time we tend to miss this statement. In the examination, we don't usually give this statement. We simply say write an algorithm to find area of a circle. So two things are implicit in this, problem definition, or the problem definition which looks like this. There are two things which are implicit. One is reading the proper variables as well as displaying the output. We might not tell you to do that in the problem definition itself. So we will not say write an algorithm to read radius and find the area of the circle and display the area. So what things will be hidden here? This thing will be hidden in the problem definition. So even if you do not specify that, it is your responsibility to do that, even if you not specify it. Because even if you don't specify it, this is a mandatory step. You cannot do this computation of finding the area of circle without having the radius. And if you do not display the result, computer means even the computer would have computed that, but user will not be able to see the computation, right? So these two things will be implicit. Input and output will be most of the time implicit. It is the responsibility of the person who is writing the algorithm to put that as a step. Okay, so in this case, step 2 and step 4 will be implicit. Only this will be given in the problem definition. Okay, hope this is clear. So I'll remove this thing now, right? So if you ask just write an algorithm to find area of circle, you need to add input as well as output. Doubts at this stage? Anyone having any doubts at this stage? Okay, right. So I will go ahead. Now this set of algorithms, these two algorithms that I showed, they are simple algorithms, but sometimes in real world scenarios we need to talk about one more set of problem definition, which is, we call it as decision making. Decision making is one such set of problem definition which is very important. Okay, so I'll write it here. Decision making. You might be asking, what is this decision making? Decision making is, given one scenario, you have to take a decision to take either this path or that path. One best analogy I can give at this stage is, suppose say after your PU2 results are out, currently the CET exams have also gone, so they'll be soon announcing the results. So after PU2, what next? So you have so many options, right? Like say you have written the CET, depending on your ranking, you will decide whether to go for engineering or whether to go for medical. That in medical, either whether you go for MBBS or other options, so on and so forth, right? Or after 10th, what next? There will be again three options which will be available for you, right? Like you want to go for science, commerce or arts. Means, given some criteria, the criteria is passing the 10th exam or clearing the PU2, you have various options, right? So depending on the criteria, you need to make some decisions. So depending on your CET score or depending on your choice, you will either select MBBS or B. If you want to go for engineering, you select B. Or if you have passed 10th, you select either science, commerce or arts, depending on your interest. So this we call it as decision making. In fact, humans are very good at decision making. That's why we have progressed, or the humanity has progressed at this level, right? So decision making is one of the most important aspects of human life, as well as computers also, because computers are given the task of making the decisions. But the problem with the computer again is, it is a very dumb machine. So all the possible options, we have to feed it to the machine or the computer, and depending on the criteria, it will decide which option to take. Okay. So the next problem definition is of type decision making. Okay. So first one was very simple, which was purely arithmetic. It simply involved addition as well as multiplication, or given an equation, finding the writing that equation in English like statements form and then printing the result. Now I'll modify this problem definition, which involves decision making. Now you might be asking, mathematically speaking, what problems constitute decision making? One of the example of decision making is, say you have been given with a number and you are asked to find whether that number is even or odd. So I'll write that problem definition here. Write an algorithm to check whether a number is even or odd. So you can see here, depending on what number you have to decide whether it is even or odd. So you have two options here. Hence, this problem definition is of type decision making. Okay. So let me show you how to write this algorithm, which involves decision making. So given a problem definition, it is your responsibility to find out with which category this algorithm lies in. So if it is a straightforward algorithm to find area and all those things, it lies in the first category. It is very trivial. If you are given with a problem definition which looks like this, you need to understand that this is a decision making type of algorithm, and such algorithms are written differently because you have two options. So a number can never be even or odd at the same time, correct? So you will not choose MBBS and BE at the same time after PU2, or nor you will choose arts, commerce and science at the same time after PU, after 10th, right? So decision making is important because once you choose that decision, you abide by that decision. So once a number is even, it can never be odd. If a number is odd, it can never be even, right? So there are two paths for this number. That number can be anything. So depending on the number, so if I enter this number as 1, it is odd. It will not be even. If I enter the number as 10, it is even. It is not odd. Okay. So you have two choices to be made, two decisions to be made, and depending on your criteria, you will choose either even or odd. Once you choose even, you have to follow with that path, and if you choose odd, you have to follow the path of odd, right? So such power definitions come under decision making type. Okay, so here you might guess what will be the input. Obviously the input is a number, so you have to read a number. So I'll call it as number, or rather I'll call it as num, num. So you are reading a number. Then what you are doing, depending on one criteria. So remember, whenever you have decision making, you have a criteria. That criteria you have to choose depending on the problem definition. Now mathematically speaking, how do I know that a number is even or odd? Say I say 10. So how do you know that 10 is even? The answer is, we all know that it divides completely by 2. We know that 7 is not even, it is odd, because it doesn't divide completely by 2, right? So that should be my basis, and that acts as a criteria in decision making. So once the criteria is written properly, most of the task of writing that algorithm which involves decision making is over, right? So criteria is a very critical step here, which we need to decide. So my next step will be check if num is divisible by 2, right? Now I can also make this more foreshortened. Instead of writing is divisible by 2, if I simply write like this, again it doesn't convey a proper meaning, because if I enter 10, 10 by 2 is 5. If I enter the num as say 7, 7 by 2 is 3, of course 3.5, but if you only take integers, it is 3. If I enter 4, 4 by 2 is 2. So you can see here, if I simply write like this and replace it with front slash, the meaning is not same as what I expected. Okay, so I am not basically not interested in a division. Of course I am interested in division, but I want the remainder of that division. You all know that division yields two outputs. One is the quotient and the other one is the remainder. If I use division operator here, what gives me is the quotient. Like 10 by 2 is 5, which is a quotient. 4 by 2, 2 is a quotient. 3 by 2, 1 or 1.5 is the quotient. I am not interested in the quotient to decide whether a number is even or odd. What I am interested is in the remainder. Now the question is there a quick way to get the remainder of a division? The answer is, fortunately, yes. Your C has, or most of the programming language have, one operator called modulo division operator, which is signified by a mod symbol. So you can either write a mod symbol here or write like this. Check if num is divisible by 2, or simply write like this. What I feel is writing this way is simple, because it is in sync with the C programming syntax. Okay. Check if num mod 2 is 0. So if you know that the remainder of division dividing a number with 2 will be always 0 if the number is indeed even. If the number is odd, what happens? When you divide that number with 2, the remainder will not be 0. It will be other than 0. In fact, it will be 1, because you are dividing it with 2. So remainder will always lie between 0 and 1. It is called as a modulo division. I hope you might have studied this in your primary school levels, primary school mathematics. This is called as modulo arithmetic. Okay, and this is a very important concept, it is used extensively in the present cryptography that we are talking about. Okay, so let us not go into all those aspects. So for this problem definition, a number is even or odd. How do I decide? Based on whether the remainder of dividing that such number with 2 is 0 or not. If it is 0, now I have written the criteria. What next? I need to choose the path, whether it is even or not, right? Check if num mod 2 is 0. If yes, what should I do? I should simply print that the number is even. So it's all about printing the number, right? So I will specify, then go to step. Currently I don't know what step it is, so I'll leave it as a blank. Okay, so I'll again continue with the same step. Now sometimes that division, if the number is odd, the remainder will not be zero. In this case, I need to go to some other step. Otherwise, go to step this one. So again, since I am writing it in the first instance, I don't know which step it is, so I'll keep it blank. So my next two steps will be simply display even. My step 5 will be display odd. Then I will stop. So now, after writing the algorithm once, you can now decide what will be the steps that are to be written over here. So if the remainder is 0, I know that the number is even, so I must go to which step? I must go to step number 4. So just fill it over here. Otherwise means what? You can also write else also here, or otherwise. If yes, you go to step 4 and say that it is even. Otherwise, go to means, otherwise means what? The remainder is not 0, 1. It means the number is odd. So I must display that the number is odd. So this is specified in the step number 5. So you write step number 5 here. So one more thing you should keep it in mind. While writing an algorithm for decision making, you will not be able to write that algorithm completely in first instance or in the first iteration or in the first pass. You might have to refer to this algorithm in the second pass. What do I mean by second pass? Initially, I was not knowing these steps, so I kept them as blank and then went ahead with display statements and then completed the algorithm. Then again, I looked into the step 3 in detail. Now I should be able to resolve these missing steps because I have written the algorithm in the first pass completely. So displaying even is specified in step number 4 and displaying odd is specified in step number 5. So I filled this step 3 completely in the second pass. So always remember that decision making algorithms always take at least two passes to complete the algorithm. Okay, so this is very important. Now you might think that the algorithm is correct, or you can just give a quick answers in the you can please give the answers in the chat box. How many of you think that this algorithm is correct? Yeah, Santosh, I will again repeat this once again with a different power definition so that you will understand it. How many of you think that this algorithm, which is written over here, is complete in all respects? I will switch over to the chat box. Answers. I want the answers. Just type it in the chat box. How many of you think that this algorithm that is shown over here is complete and it is according to the problem definition of whether checking whether a number is even or odd? Okay, so no answers, right? So why I asked this question over here is because this algorithm looks correct. But if you see it properly or if you observe it carefully, it is incorrect. Our human brains think that just by looking into the algorithm, we think that it is correct, but in reality it is not correct. So I will try to prove that this is not correct. To do that, let us first consider a number which is actually odd, right? So let us take the number as, say, num equal to, say, 3, right? So what is 3 mod 2? 3 mod 2, what is the remainder? It is 1. If you divide 3 with 2, quotient will be 1 and remainder will be 1. Remember, we are talking about integer division. We are not talking about floating point division. So you will not get 1.5 as a quotient there. Okay. So you will stop when you have the remainder, which is less than the divisor. Okay. So the remainder is 1. So it is not 0. So it should go to the step 5. And what is step 5? It displays odd and then executes the next step, stops. So for the input, which is odd, it indeed displays odd as a output, right? So this is correct. But what if I enter a number which is even, say 8? Now I'll take number as 8, right? So what is 8 mod 2? 8 mod 2, obviously it 2 divides 8 completely, so the remainder is 0, right? Now what happens in the third step? In the second step, I read the number which is 8. In the third step, it checks whether that 8 mod 2 is 0. It is indeed 0. So it is yes. So it will go to the fourth step. And what is the fourth step? It is simply displaying even. So it displays even. Now, we all humans think that it will go to the stop. But in reality, it will not. It will still execute the next step. So what happens is, this algorithm prints even as well as odd. I hope you are able to understand the problem with this algorithm. This algorithm seems complete, but it is not, because after displaying even, the algorithm should stop. But this is not happening. After the fourth step, you have not specified or you have not told the computer to stop. So what happens? Automatically, since all the steps are incremental, they are sequential, after the fourth step, it will still execute the fifth step and then stop. So for an odd numbered number, it displays proper output. For an even numbered number, it displays both as output. What is the solution for this? After displaying even, you have to tell the machine to stop. So you write display even, then go to step, which is the step that stops or terminates the algorithm. Step number 6. Now this algorithm is correct, because when it displays even, you are telling that algorithm to execute the last step, which is to stop. So now it will not display both as the output, it will only display even as the output. I hope you got the point in regarding algorithms which take care of decision making. Any questions? You can ask. I'll be monitoring the chat now. You can just ask the question, or if you want to enable your audio and want to ask the question, you can do that. I'll wait for a few seconds. If there is no response, I'll go ahead with the next one. It means that you don't have any questions. Right then, it seems there are no questions in this at this stage. So I'll go ahead. I'll take one more example, the last example of algorithm, then I'll switch over to the flowchart. Now, we have now solved the algorithm to check whether number is even or not. This time, I want to compare two numbers and interpret which one is greater than the other, right? So, I will rewrite this, I will put one more power definition now. Write an algorithm to check whether a number is greater than the other, right? So this is one way in which this problem can be asked, or it can also be asked in this way. Write an algorithm to print whether write an algorithm to print greatest of two numbers. So it is just the way it has been framed, but the meaning of this problem definition is one and the same. So I want to make it simpler, so I have written this way. The problem definition says, write an algorithm to check whether a number is greater than the other, right? So why this falls under decision making? Because you are checking whether one number is greater than the other. What this also means internally is that you are reading two numbers, because without having two number, how can we compare that one is greater than the other? So implicit to this problem definition is you are supposed to read two numbers, right? So criteria we'll decide later. So first we'll have to understand that. Just a sec, give me a second. There is some disturbance. Okay, so this problem definition is of type decision making, because you are given with two options. One is whether the first number is greater or the other number is greater. So how do you check for greater? In mathematics, we just say greater symbol, right? So two numbers are to check for greater than, you use greater symbol, right? So if indeed A is greater than B, you say that A is greater. Otherwise, you say that B is greater. So you have been given with two options, whether A is greater or B is greater. So since you have been given with two options, this algorithm comes under decision making kind. Okay, so this is very important. Given a problem definition, you should develop the competence to identify to which category this algorithm belongs to, whether it's a normal algorithm or whether this algorithm requires decision making or not. I'm talking about trivial problem definitions. More advanced problem definitions, you need to again think in terms of their level. Okay, right. So now I know that this problem definition is of type decision making and it requires two numbers. I will modify this second step now. I will say read A and B, because I know that it requires minimum to compare to comment whether one is greater than the other. I must have at least two numbers, right? So I will write read A and B. Now you will modify this step. Third step is check if A is greater than B. If A is greater than B, you will go to the one step. Which step? I will decide later. Which step? I will decide later. And even otherwise means if A is not greater than B, which step I will decide later, right? So there are two options for this comparison. One, A will be greater, other B will be greater. So I will remove this step. I will say display A is greater. Otherwise display B is greater, right? So you can see here, this algorithm similarly follows the previous algorithm itself. In fact, number of steps and the overall structure of this algorithm is same as the previous one, because previous algorithm was also of decision making kind. Even this algorithm is also of type decision making kind. So it will not have any difference. The structure of this algorithm will remain same. Okay. So if A was indeed greater than B, what would have happened? You should display A is greater here. So I'm just making it bold. It doesn't mean that when you are writing, you can make it bold. It's not like that. Just to highlight that A and B, I'm doing it. Okay. Because I'm using Word, I have that capability to make it bold. So I'm using it. Okay. So if A is indeed greater than B, it will go to, obviously it should go to step 4. So write it here. And as we saw in the previous algorithm, after displaying A is greater, I must or the machine should stop that algorithm, right? So I will write, then go to step 6. Now, what is last thing to be filled here is, if A was not greater than B, means If b is greater, it will go to step number 5, which is display b is greater, and then stop. I hope you understood this algorithm. This is very similar to the previous one, right? Fine. So now, how do I know that this algorithm behaves the way I designed it to behave? For this, we will take one example and try to do it. This I call it as a tracing or dry run. Okay, so this is actually a skill which you have to develop. Without tracing that algorithm for few inputs, do not judge that this algorithm is correct just because it looks like correct. I already proved this fact in the previous problem definition. I had not specified this, but the algorithm seemed correct. But when I tried to trace it, I found that algorithm had some bugs or loopholes. So please try to trace it so that you will come to know that this algorithm, which seems correct, is indeed correct. Okay, right. So because our human minds tend to go to the conclusion very often. Based on our previous experience, we try to conclude that it will be like this. But in reality, it will not be so, right? Right. So first, I'll consider A and B as say 4 and 5. So A equal to 4, B equal to 5. So what is the comparison? 4 greater than 5. Is 4 greater than 5? Means A is 4, B is 5. Is 4 greater than 5? Obviously, no, right? So it will go to the step 5 and says display B is greater. So it says B is greater. So indeed, B is greater in this case, right? Suppose what if I take one more example, say in this case A equal to 20, B equal to 10, right? So what is the comparison now? 20 greater than 10. Is 20 greater than 10? Indeed it is. So it is yes. So third step, it is yes. So it should go to the fourth step. And what is the fourth step? It will display A is greater. So this displays A is greater, and after displaying A is greater, it stops because I have written then go to step 6. If I had not written this, you know what happens from the previous problem definition. Okay, so this is the algorithm. Now there is one trick in the sense, there is one interesting aspect here, right? Okay, now what if A and B are same? What if A and B are same? What happens to this comparison? Can anyone tell me in the chat what will be the output for this? What if I enter A and B as same, say 5 and 5? What will be the output of 5 greater than 5? What is your guess? You all have completed PU2 mathematics level. So you all have completed that course, so you should be able to at least put an answer in this. What do you think? 5 is 20 greater than 10 is true, correct? Means it is indeed 20 is greater than 10. 4 is greater than 5? No, it is not. Now what is 5 greater than 5? What is your guess? Means what I am trying to tell is, what happens to this step? Whether it will be yes, or it will be else, or it will be otherwise. Is 5 greater than 5? Is 5 greater than 5? The answer is 5 is not greater than 5. It is equal to 5, right? So greater than 5 is obviously not greater than 5, right? So it will go to step 5 and print B is greater, correct? So this is the algorithm. Right, so I'm not saying that this algorithm is wrong. I just gave you one interesting scenario, right? So 5 greater than 5, according to the greater than operator in mathematics, it is 5 is not greater than 5 because 5 is equal to 5. That 5 equal to 5 is implicit. That is not taken care by this greater than operator, right? So 5 greater than 5, it still prints B is greater. So if you are able to write a program for this and check it, it will still print. Maybe in the tomorrow's class, I will introduce a program for this, right? And when I compile it and run it, it indeed prints B is greater when I give A and B as 5. Okay, I hope you understood this. So this is all about algorithms. Any doubts with respect to this? So I have covered two aspects of types of algorithm. One is a normal algorithm, which are very trivial, wherein you will be given with equations to solve. You just need to write the equation in the proper steps and compute it and then display the result. The second type of algorithm are decision making in nature, wherein you need to decide, depending on the criteria, you need to decide which option you choose. And once you choose that option, you cannot revert back to the other option, right? So given two choices, you need to take one choice, and that depends on the decision criteria that you choose. Okay, and also one more thing important in this I missed. You can logically divide these steps of the algorithms into start and stop. These are called as initialization and termination conditions, initial and termination steps. Next comes the optional read and write. Okay, read and write means input output. So step 2 and step 5 as well as step 4, they are output steps. And the third step will be either computation step or condition checking step. For finding the addition of two numbers, it was compute C equal to A plus B. For finding the area of a circle, it was compute area equal to pi r square, right? So that was computation, right? So logically, if you want to divide the algorithm steps, you can divide it like this. Initial and termination is one such logical category. The second category of steps are input, output steps, and the third category of steps are computation or decision making steps. So given any step from any algorithm you pick, that step will be put into either one of these categories. Say take the step 6, it gets put into this category. Take the step number 4, display, so it gets put into this category. Step number 3, it's a decision making step, so it gets put into this category. So if you can remember or you can understand these categories, designing the algorithm becomes easier. And if you are able to understand this, you will be able to easily understand the flowchart, right? So I will now take the flowchart. Before that, any other questions or any questions regarding the algorithms, you can put it in the chat box, or you can unmute your mic and then ask the question straight away. If no questions, I'll wait for a few seconds and then I'll continue, assuming that you don't have any questions in this algorithms, right? Okay, so I'm not seeing any chat messages over here. So I'll continue. Next is flowchart. The second aspect of today's discussion is flowchart. But before going with the flowchart, we must have understood the algorithm, because flowchart is a special case of algorithm. This statement I already made before. If you can recollect, you can see here. Flowchart is just one way of expressing an algorithm, or flowchart is one way of representing an algorithm. Now you might ask, why should I use flowchart when I already know how to write an algorithm? Because in the examination, you might be asked to write algorithm or flowchart. Or if you are not so lucky enough, we might directly ask you to write flowchart. We will not be giving you any option. So you might ask why flowcharts are required once you know how to write an algorithm. The only reason is why we use flowcharts is because if the algorithm is of decision making and there are so many decisions to be made in that problem definition, and if you are writing algorithm for such problem definitions, then the algorithm looks very clumsy and becomes almost unreadable. One example I can give you Here I have tried to find the check whether a number is greater than the other. But what if I give three numbers, say A, B and C, and decide and ask you to print which is greater among these three? Or I might give you four numbers and ask you to print which is greatest among four. In that case, the number of comparisons increase exponentially. And realizing an algorithm which has English-like statements becomes very difficult. First of all, writing becomes difficult for such problem definitions. Writing an algorithm in this fashion becomes difficult, as well as checking for the correctness of that algorithm also becomes difficult. So instead of going for this approach, which is like writing algorithm as a natural language statement, we go for something called as flowchart, which exploits diagrammatic representation of the steps. Okay, so what is a flowchart? A flowchart is basically a graphical representation of the algorithm. Okay, so I already said a flowchart is a special case of algorithm. In what sense it is a special case? It is like this. This is a formal definition of a flowchart. So what is a flowchart? A flowchart is a graphic representation of how a process works. What do you mean by a process works? It's basically an algorithm only. It's a graphical representation of how a process works, showing at a minimum. Means, of course, you need to optimize this flowchart. It should show minimum number of steps. Okay. So some ambiguous steps, or if you can combine two or more steps into one step, it would be better. Okay. So the description or the definition of flowchart goes like this. A flowchart is a graphic representation of how a process works, showing at a minimum the sequence of steps. What were these sequence of steps? These were taken from the algorithm itself, right? Right. So if you indeed want to write a flowchart, in your mind you should clearly have the algorithm for that problem definition. Without having the algorithm, if you start writing the flowchart, simply it becomes a waste of effort. Okay, and since it's a graphical representation, our human eye will be easily able to interpret the correctness of the flowchart in a crisp and easy way. Because if you use algorithm, there will be a lot of English statements wherein user or the human have to read it, right? You all know that in the road, you have so many signs, road signs. The reason is because if you just see the sign, you will understand what that sign is for. They will usually never use Kannada or English statements to specify the signs, right? So they will not say stop, start and all like that. They only specify it with the help of colors, right? Red in the traffic junction, you have red for stop, yellow for preparing to stop or preparing to start, and green for start, right? So like this, why the if you consider the entire world, wherever you have the roads, wherever you have highways, wherever you have state highways, they always specify the indicators via the symbols, because human brain reads the graphical symbols better compared to the languages. Because you all know that during the evolution, always the symbols came into first. At last we learned was the languages. Okay, because learning a language takes some effort, right? And not everyone is comfortable with a particular language. Many people, they still do not know how to read that language, right? So they graphically represent those signs. Same way, we are trying to follow the same approach here. So by rewriting the algorithm in a graphical way, I'll be able to easily grasp what that algorithm does, because it's simply a graphical representation. Human mind can easily understand the symbols, right? So there are various symbols that are used to devise a flowchart, which have been, in fact, there are so many symbols. The basic ones which are essential for learning at this stage, only I have jotted here. I'm simply going to make some space for displaying all four over here. Yeah. In the algorithm, we had start and stop steps, right? So we signify such things with the help of a rounded rectangle. Okay, so what does rounded rectangle signifies? It actually signifies the header, or it signifies the start and stop step. So when I am designing a flowchart, always I should have these two, a pair of these symbols wherein I write start as well as stop, right? So it goes like this. First I need to write start, then after some steps I need to write stop. Okay, so just need to write like this. You might be asking whether the all these English letters should be written in capital letter. It need not be. You can also write it like this, start as well as stop. Okay, right. So these two should be the these two act as a first as well as the last steps of the algorithm, right? But you can see here, since they are graphical representation, they are easy to grasp, right? I hope you are understanding what I mean by that. Okay, so a rounded rectangle, it, remember, you have to write a rounded rectangle, means the, you should not have a sharp edges for that. You should have a rounded rectangle. So rounded rectangle signifies that it acts as either a initial or a start of that algorithm, and it also acts as a stop of the algorithm. So these two blocks must be there in all of your flowchart. I'm sorry, it's not algorithm, it's a flowchart. Okay, so these two blocks must be there in your all flowcharts, because if it is not there, your machine will not start as well as stop. Okay, the next one is the rectangle. You just use a rectangle here. It refers to as a regular statement. You might be asking, what is this regular statement? The addition of two numbers, the equation is C equal to A plus B. Finding the area of a circle, area equal to pi r square. All those things which we refer to it as a computations, they all form regular statements. Okay, so if I want to write the flowchart for that problem definition of addition of two numbers, that C equal to A plus B, I will put it in a rectangle. Okay, so rounded rectangle for start and stop, rectangle for regular statement, basically your computation statements. Then if at all you are making some decisions, right, if your problem definition requires decision making, you will use this symbol, which is called as a rhombus symbol, correct? In fact, it's a square tilted 90 degrees, okay, either in clockwise or counterclockwise direction. Okay, so it's a rhombus, and that criteria like A greater than B or num mod to 0, you write it here. Okay, so this is a rhombus symbol, signifies decision making. Okay, and your algorithm also had a read as well as display, right? It has input or output. So for this we write a parallelogram, but it is more towards a rectangle, right? So it's like a slanted rectangle. That slant is towards a positive x-axis. Okay, so if you imagine it, this as an entire rectangle, that slant is towards positive x-axis. It's like putting a shear along positive x-axis. Okay, so you are putting a y shear along positive x-axis, right? So it's like a parallelogram, but it's a kind of a rectangle, right? So input output, like read and display, you all specify that read and display in the form of a parallelogram. Okay, so this is how it is. Next one is, sometimes if your flowchart spans multiple pages, this of course will not be using it here. You need to use a connector. So this is referred to basically as a connector. A circle is referred to as a connector. Inside this circle, you basically write the labels like A, B, C and all. Of course, you'll not be using much on this, so I'll basically skip over this. Now, in the algorithm, if you see this algorithm, you had step number 1, 2, 3, so on and so forth, right? So after step number 1, you automatically, your machine knows that it should execute the next step, right? So they were sequential, right? Here, since flowchart specifies the flow, and this movement of data from one block to another block is actually done via an arrow mark, right? So usually we use a arrow mark like this, right? So downward arrow mark means from the above block, the data moves towards the below block. Okay, so this is specified with an arrow mark. Okay, so these are few of the symbols that are used. Of course, there are so many other symbols that are used. These are the most commonly used symbols. I'll put that arrow mark here and delete these things. Okay, so a rounded rectangle, a rectangle, a rhombus, parallelogram, and arrow mark, downward arrow mark. Okay, so I'll again repeat, a rounded rectangle specifies start and stop steps, rectangle specifies regular statements or equations or computation statements, decision making statements are written with within a rhombus, parallelograms are the statements which act as a input output, they are written with the parallelograms, and downward arrow mark signifies the movement of data from the previous block to the next block. Okay, so having seen this, now let us try to write a flowchart. Okay, for the previous algorithms, right, so I'll try to do that. See, I want to just manage the time, so I'll just write this problem definition over here. We don't say write a flowchart, we usually say draw a flowchart, because flowcharts are symbolic representations, so you should take some time to draw them neatly. Okay, so you just cannot write the flowchart haphazardly, right? So draw a flowchart to add that adds two numbers. Okay, so I will do that now. First, the first step towards that is start and stop. So I'll do that. So my first step will be start. So I'll reduce the font size over here so that it fits properly. Right? Okay. So this is the start of the flowchart, which was the next step in our algorithm of adding two numbers. We are reading the statements, right? So it must be a parallelogram, right? So I'll copy this, paste it over here, right? Of course, here the flowchart is not looking nice. It might not look nice, but when you are practicing it, do practice it properly. It should look nice, okay? I'll maintain the uniform font sizes here, right? So that I can reduce it, reduce the blocks and fit them in a same alignment, okay? So input output, what should I write? Read A and B. Okay, so this was the second step of that algorithm. So this flowchart is, you are supposed to draw a flowchart that adds two numbers. Okay, the next one is, here it doesn't require decision making, so I'll remove this. I'll basically cut this and keep it somewhere else. Next one is, after reading A and B, I want to compute that, right? So I'll again reduce the font size for this. I'll simply say C equal to A plus B. You can see here, previously in the algorithm, we said step compute C equal to A plus B. Here, simply I can write C equal to A plus B. Okay. Try to align it properly. Here I might not do it correctly, but in the exam, you must do it. After performing the read A and B, computing the result C equal to A plus B, you are supposed to display it, right? So I'll simply copy paste this. Okay. Then say display C. Okay. Then copy this. Say stop. In fact, I don't use any capital, I don't want to use some capital letters here. So just write like this. Now what is left here is, of course, our algorithm is now, our flowchart is finished. What is left is, we just need to put a connector over here, right? So I'll do that now. So after the first step, the algorithm should go to the next step. So I'll put it here like this. There are some advanced tools in the internet which can easily make this task easier. Drawing algorithm using the computer very easier. Okay, so this, the arrow mark is not aligned properly. It's okay. Next, after the start, after reading again, you need to go to the next step. So this is specified with again a downward arrow mark. okay, right? It is not getting aligned properly, leave it. Next, after C equal to A plus B, again you are displaying it. So again one arrow mark. After that, again one arrow mark. Okay. So as I said, these are not aligned properly. These arrow marks are not properly aligned. Their alignment with respect to horizontal vertical axis along y axis is not correct. You just need to excuse me for this. It's not simply working. Can leave it. But when you are drawing the down arrow mark, see to it that it is perfectly vertical. Okay. So this is the flowchart that adds two numbers. If you have any questions here, you can put it in the chat option available here, or you can also unmute your mic and ask the question. I hope there are no questions. I'll go ahead. So this is the basic flowchart to add two numbers. The next is we considered finding the area of circle. Draw a flowchart that finds area of a circle. Okay, that computes area of a circle. Right. So I'll modify this flowchart and then make this flowchart to find the area of a circle. So we had already seen that in the previous algorithm. It requires only one input, which is the radius. So I'll now say read radius. Okay. Next, instead of saying compute, I'll simply write area equal to 3.142 star radius. Okay. Next is simply display the area, right? And then stop. So you can see here, it is so simple, right? And also, since it's a graphical representation, just by looking into this flowchart, you will be able to understand what this flowchart does. Okay, because it's a graphical representation, analyzing the flowchart is very easy. Okay, so even if you want to trace it, you can do that. Okay, right? So this is the flowchart for computing the area of a circle. Okay, if you now remember, for algorithms we try to write the algorithm for decision making problems. We'll try to do the same thing for this. So I demonstrated you the algorithm for checking whether a number is even or odd, right? So for the same algorithm, I'll try to write the flowchart now. Draw a flowchart to check whether a number is even or odd. Now, this requires decision making, and we know that there is only one input for this. So I'll now modify this like this: read num. Next, I do not have the computation here, rather I have a decision making here. So I need to introduce the proper symbols at this stage. I will now introduce. HOD sir, UP Kukla sir is willing to talk to you all. So I'll just switch over the mic to sir.
Hello, my dear students. Are you listening? Yeah. See, you all people interact with your concerned teacher and in a Google group, WhatsApp group, whatever is being created, right? You please go through all the things and take help of your teacher in a regular classes, whatever we do, right? Please go through that. Okay, that's all I can tell you, and all the best. Go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, HOD sir. I'll now continue. Okay, so since this requires a decision making, I need to use that proper symbol. For decision making, we always use this rhombus symbol as told previously. So I'm now going to introduce that rhombus symbol over here. Okay, I'll properly align it so that it fits into this. Okay, so I'll quickly make some modifications to this. Okay, right. Next, what was the condition we checked to check whether a number is even or not? we find the found out the mod operation, right? So I'll just put this here. I'll write this is num mod 2, num mod 2, just a sec. I will have to reduce the settings here. Okay, reduce the font size also. Is num mod 2 0? Okay, yeah, is num mod 2 0. So the algorithm that we wrote was, in the third step we wrote, check if the num mod 2 is 0. If yes, print that it is even, otherwise print that it is odd, right? So this way I have done it in the decision making. So inside the decision making symbol, which is rhombus symbol, you just write this text. Again, what is to be written here is again left to you. So you can either directly write num mod 2 0, but I am just writing is num mod 2 0, a question mark. So depending on the input, it will be either 0 or not, right? So it will be either even or odd, right? So what if it is even, correct? So if it is even, means if num mod 2 is indeed 0, it must be even. So I must display what? I must display that the number is even. So I'll write it here. So I have two displays. One is displaying even, the other one is displaying odd. Okay, so displaying even, displaying odd. So I'll change this to odd. So if it is indeed 0, okay, so if it is indeed 0, I need to put it like this. I'll quickly change the outline of this to black color, and make it bold, right? So if it is indeed 0, you must print that the number is even. Okay, I'll now quickly copy this and change it. Somehow this paste is not working. I'll exactly try to paste it in the proper location. Try to shrink its size. Okay, right. Of course, I should have used some advanced tools, but I didn't have the time to do that, right? So if it is true, so you can of course optionally write yes here, means on top of this one, yes, or you can also write one means true, right? Or true means what? If that number is indeed 0, what if that number is not true? What if the number is not, means that remainder is not 0, right? So in that case it will be false, right? So in both situations you need to terminate, right? So I will, that also I'll put it as an arrow mark here. So after displaying odd, you must terminate. Okay, I'll again have to change the shape, outline, as well as the weight, right? And the same thing also need to be done at the other end. Okay, I'll just modify this like this, right? So again, change the borders and all those things, right? Okay, so this is my algorithm, this is my flowchart to check whether a number is even or not. So you can see here, while writing that algorithm, we did worry about the fourth step, right? Right, we just wrote then go to step 6, otherwise our algorithm would have been incorrect, right? In flowchart, this is automatically taken care. Can you see here? If the number is, say, even, so means the remainder will be 0, so it comes here and says that display even and directly comes to a stop. If the number is odd, then remainder will not be 0, so it comes, takes this path, displays odd and stops. So you can see here, this looks clean, this looks visually appealing, and for the human brain easily interpretable. Okay, so that is the powerful feature of a flowchart. Okay, any questions? Right. So if there are no questions, I will quickly show the flowchart for checking whether a number is greater than the other. Right. So we discussed the algorithm for finding the greatest of the other number. So I'll modify it now. Draw a flowchart to check whether a number is greater than the other. Right. So here what? Okay, I just need to make some modifications here. Okay, so my overall structure of this flowchart is ready. I just need to change the values over here. Read A and B. So you will write, is A greater than B? So I can make it a bit larger. Okay, so is A greater than B? In that case, no need to write 0 because depending on A greater than B, you decide, right? Right. So I can simply write like this. Put some font size. Okay. Right. So is A greater than B? If indeed A is greater than B, means true, what you would display? You would display A is greater. Yeah, one more thing here, when you are writing a flowchart, you need not have to write display here, because when you are using a rhombus symbol, sorry, when you are using a parallelogram, it internally means that you are performing input output, right? So no need to specify a display over here, right? So if A is not greater than B, obviously this will become false. So it will take this path, it will print B is greater, okay? So this is the end of this flowchart, correct? So you can see here, it is very simple. You are reading two numbers A and B. Check whether A is greater than B. If indeed A is greater than B, it displays A is greater. If A is not greater than B, displays B is greater. And in both situations, comes to a stop. This is the flowchart for checking whether a number is greater than the other. If you have any doubts regarding algorithm and flowchart, you can ask the doubts in the chat section or unmute your mic and then ask the doubts. Any doubts? Then I think we will conclude for today's. We will conclude today's session. We will meet tomorrow at the same time, exactly at 10 o'clock. So do join by exactly 10 o'clock. So that tomorrow's session is very important, right? So we are covering the basics, fundamentals of C, right? So please join by sharp 10 o'clock so that we can utilize full 2 hours of session. Okay. Thank you all. Let's meet tomorrow. Okay. Bye.